My name is Rex Chisholm. I'm director of the Center for Genetic Medicine here at Northwestern University, and I'm really delighted to see such a terrific crowd here for our event this evening. The event is the Silverstein Lecture Series, and the goal of the Silverstein Lecture Series is to provide the public a place where they can begin to learn about some of the complex issues that surround genetics and genetic medicine. And you know, one of those issues that's been in the news a lot lately is this issue of genes and race, and we have an absolutely exciting and dynamic speaker tonight to talk to us about this really important and interesting topic. A couple of words first about the Silverstein Lecture Series. They're made possible by a very generous gift from the Silverstein Foundation. Silverstein Foundation was established by a bequest from the from Herman and Bea Silverstein. Herman Silverstein was an eminent attorney in the city of Chicago. He was president of Mid-American National Bank and then went on to serve on a number of boards here in the city. He was a very generous donor to a variety of organizations here in the city of Chicago, ranging from things like the Art Institute of Chicago, where he helped fund a exhibit on armaments, ranging to funding a waiting room that made it easier for surgical patients and surgical families of people undergoing surgery here at Northwestern Memorial Hospital to pass that difficult time. I should also say that if you like what you hear tonight, and I'm pretty sure you will, that you should be paying attention, because early next year, probably in April or May, we haven't set the dates yet, we're going to have one more event that will focus on the same topic of genes and race and try to see if we can help continue this dialogue that we will hope will start this evening. So I would invite all of you to be aware of that and to keep your eye open for that event, which we think will be, as I said, sometime in the late spring. All right, now that I've got the housekeeping out of the way, I'd like to introduce our speaker for this evening. Dr. Rick Kittles is an associate professor in the Department of Molecular Virology, Immunology, and Medical Genetics, and in the Division of Human Cancer Genetics at the Comprehensive Cancer Center at Ohio State University. Rick was born in Georgia and then went on to do bachelor's work at Rochester Institute of Technology in the Department of Biology, got a master's degree in the Master's of Science program at the State University of New York at Brockport, and then went on to PhD work at George Washington University, where he studied population genetics, systematics and evolution, and biological anthropology. And that clearly prepared him extremely well for the research path that he's undertaken since then. He also served as a human genome research associate between Howard University and the National Human Genome Institute, and then began his academic career as an assistant professor at Howard University, where he was until just this summer when he moved to Ohio State. Rick's interests are very broad, and they range from trying to understand the genetic basis of complex disease on through question, particularly things like prostate cancer. He's interested in how things like the ultraviolet exposure affect susceptibility to cancer. And he's particularly interested in the role of race and how race is defined, and the genetics of ancestry and populations. And that's the exciting topic that he'll tell us tonight. So I hope you'll all join me in welcoming Dr. Rick Kittles.
Okay. I'm a geneticist by training. Sort of, I wear many hats, an anthropologist, and I'm into evolutionary biology, and I see things differently than many geneticists, you know, the traditionally trained geneticists. And so my talk today is sort of eclectic. eclectic. It's a nice word, eclectic. But I have to be honest with you, some of you might get uncomfortable by the end of the hour. You might get a little bit uncomfortable, some of us in this room. But that's okay, because when we talk about race and issues of race, there is a discomfort, especially here in the United States, which is why there's such a problem. It's so problematic because of the social political history in the United States. And so what I intend to do is talk some about this issue of race, or the lack thereof in terms of a biological significance, but also how genetics is sort of, genomics and technology are now intersecting with these issues, these societal issues, such as group membership, how we define ourselves, how other people define you, and how these biomedical studies are designed, and the relevance of certain types of studies. So it'll be interesting. I don't know, does this sound okay?
Yes.
Okay, great. All right, well, race, genetic ancestry, and disease. A couple years ago, there was this international group of scientists whose goal was to sequence the entire human genome, and in fact, they did that. They sequenced the genome. It was about a little over 3 billion base pairs, these A's, C's, T's, and G's. These chemical bases that represent these letters are situated on these 23 pairs of chromosomes, and we see here 23 pairs. Can we dim this light a little bit? 23 pairs of chromosomes. There's 22 of these autosomes, we call them. And then there's these sex chromosomes, XY. That's what separates men from women, the X and the Y chromosome. Women have two X's, men have an X and a Y, right? See that little piece of DNA there, the Y? That's what created so much havoc in the world. That's why I'm a male. I got that Y from my father. But anyway, I'm going to show you some pretty interesting data and show you some more pictures of this Y chromosome a little later. So when we talk about race, race is interesting because for a very long time, even before modern genomics or modern genetics or evolutionary genetic thinking was pronounced was examined more holistically, there were scientists who said, well, we can categorize different human populations. And so there was this guy named Carl Linnaeus, who was a Swedish botanist, who said, yeah, well, there's different varieties of man. And he came up with this classification scheme, Homo sapien eurapius. He called it the light and lively. Homo sapien asiaticus, stern and stingy type. Homo sapien americanus, tenacious and contented. Homo sapien afer, these were the Africans, the cunning and slow. I guess he didn't know anything about basketball or football players. But what's interesting is that these were characters of the mind and not necessarily the body. He was characterizing humans based on these mental or personality sort of characteristics, okay? And after Linnaeus came Blumenbach, and so presently Blumenbach's classification scheme is pretty commonly used still today. Blumenbach says, okay, well, we can separate man based on these different varieties of skin color. And still today, people say, I can walk down the street and I can say who's who, mainly based on skin color. So Caucasians is white, Mongolians yellow, Ethiopians black, American red, and Malayans brown. The color scheme, okay? And still today, as I said, people use this, you know, but now we don't use the term Ethiopian for black, it's African now, and Caucasian, some people still use that. Other people say European. Mongolian, I think it's a bad term, but some people's, you know, Mongolian, you know, Asian, and Malayan, the Southeast Asians. Very interesting. So why is race problematic? Well, the thrust of this is that race does not fully explain human biological variation. That's important to understand because you can't categorize biological features or genetic features into these racial groups. And there's a social-cultural meaning in this colloquial use of the term. And so the social-cultural people or the social scientists say we should define race based on the cultural sort of significance. There are different ethnic groups, okay? And race has some meaning in the cultural context. But for the geneticists and many biologists, they aren't necessarily agreeing with that. And so we have this lack of discourse between disciplines. And I think one of the things over the next 5 years, one of the things that's going to happen is that there will be some interaction between these disciplines. You know, the geneticists don't like the social scientists. Social scientists don't like the geneticists or the biologists. You know, we say, oh, social scientists, that's a soft science. You know, those folks don't know what they don't. They didn't take calculus. But you'll see by the end of my talk that there is strong social context in what I do. And I think an increase in discourse between the disciplines is going to be useful for dealing with this issue of race. Now, one of the problems is when race is used as a causal genetic variable, it leads to biological determinism. So what does that mean? Like, Tay-Sachs is a Jewish gene. Sickle cell disease is an African disease. So, you know, here you have these genetic variants or diseases that are more common in certain populations are then booted up to represent all of those people in those populations. Not all black people have sickle cell disease. Not all Jews have Tay-Sachs or BRCA1 mutations. Okay, those are genetic variants that may lead to disease that are segregating in families, in communities, and in certain populations, but they don't represent all of those populations. So here comes the intersection with technology. So we have this post-genome sequencing here. We've just finished sequencing the genome, 3.5 billion nucleotides, and we have some implications here, challenges now in the post-genome sequencing era, such as, first challenge, health disparities. I'm going to talk some about health disparities. What is a health disparity? Maybe it's not necessarily biological, but we need to find out. And so we need to be able to identify certain populations who are at risk or might be more susceptible to certain diseases. And we need to determine if it's biological in etiology or maybe cultural. Maybe instead of health disparities, it's really wealth disparities. So I'm going to show you some data on that. The whole issue of group definition and membership, very important issue. People want to know about their family history. People want to know about their ancestry. And so we now have this genetic technology that allows us to dwell deeper and determine some genetic ancestry that you may not necessarily know you had. The last two are very important, and this is sort of what, as a geneticist, a human geneticist that looks at complex diseases, I am very interested in these questions. What is the level of sequence variation that's found within and between human populations? We know very little about the extent of genetic variation. We know for certain populations, but there's an enormous amount of different human populations that we know very, very little about. And then the most significant question, or the most significant challenge, how does this variation contribute to variation and susceptibility to complex disease, such as prostate cancer and hypertension? You know, we know that variation may contribute, but how much of that variation contributes? So my talk, I'm going to explain something about what we know about genetic variation and how it's structured. I'm going to talk about the importance of population history and shared ancestry. And I'm going to use African Americans as an example. Why? Because I'm black. Okay? Thank you. I'm going to talk about using self-described ancestry as a proxy for shared genetic and environmental factors. I'm going to talk about the pros and cons of that. The usefulness of using race, or not necessarily race, but self-described ethnicity as a proxy, and then some of the pitfalls and problems when using that. And I'm going to use some genetic studies as examples. I'm going to talk some about genetic ancestry, skin color, which I'm very interested in, and prostate cancer. I think skin color is interesting because when I was in high school, in a lot of my classes, I was the only black student. And so I would look around the class and see people with different, they didn't have different, it was pretty homogeneous, but I was the only one with different skin color and hair. I had hair back then, so they had different hair and eye color. And I always wondered what was contributing to those differences. And so now it's come full circle where I'm actually looking at the genetics of skin color. But this is a Venn diagram showing the partitioning of genetic variation across different populations, the major continents, populations within major continents. This is data from Sarah Tishkoff, who's at the University of Maryland. She looked at this gene called CD4, and she looked at polymorphisms within the CD4 gene. The CD4 is one of those receptors on some immune cells in the immune system, these cells that are involved in the immune response. So she looked at populations from Africa, Europe, and Asia, and found that, lo and behold, there was more genetic variation in African populations. In fact, it was close to 200 different types for this particular gene in Africa. Among Europeans, it was close to 100, about 75 or so in Asian populations. So then she said, well, let's look at how those variants are structured across different populations. In fact, half of the variants she found in Africa were specific to African populations. Striking, striking differences there in terms of variation. Why is that? Well, Africa is the cradle of modern humans. It's where modern humans evolved. It's where they started. You guys didn't know that, did you? I'm not telling you anything new. But this, when you look across different genetic systems, we see the same pattern, okay? We find this enormous diversity in African populations, and a lot of it is exclusive just to Africans. And then we have, so it's 50% exclusive to Africans, about 10% exclusive to Europeans, 10% in Asians, okay? And then we have this 46 here, which represents that shared sort of history. Those are common variants. Those are variants that are common across all populations. Now, it's interesting because some people think that these variants here might be those that increase susceptibility to common complex diseases like diabetes and asthma, you know, that we see across all populations, okay? I'm not one of those that think that, but there are some who think that. It's called the common disease, common variant hypothesis. So when we look across different genes, we see the same thing as what we see here. This shows why we see what we see when we look across those different genes. We see here this tree, this divergence of modern humans, that the trunk of the tree is African populations. So as modern humans evolved about 200,000 years ago, they evolved in Africa. So humanity was in Africa for a very long time, and African populations are older and bigger. And so then there was some population divergence, less than 200, about 150,000 years ago. And guess where that was happening at? In Africa, okay? And then we have this migration out of Africa about 80,000 years ago. Now, the interesting thing about that is a subset of the variation in African populations left Africa and went into Europe, Asia, the Americas, and Oceania. We all got that? Subset of the variation. Not all of it, just some of it. And that's why when you look at those Venn diagrams, you see the big circle for the African populations and the smaller ones for the other continental populations or populations in the other continents. But there's some overlap there because there's some shared history here, okay? And then there's the divergence of those populations evolving on those continents alone. And then through time, you have new variants, new genetic variants. Genetics is cool because we can actually trace migrations using genes. We can trace the history of humanity out of Africa 100,000 years ago into the Middle East 80,000 years ago, throughout Asia, Southeast Asia, and to Europe 40,000 years ago. And then across the Bering Straits, 15, some people say 12,000, let's just say 20,000 years ago, into the Americas. And we can actually look at particular genetic variants that are common in those regions, those geographic regions, okay? So when we talk about the genetics of African populations, it tells us something about human evolution. Higher genetic diversity, strong evidence for the African origin of modern humans. And then this linkage disequilibrium. I'm not going to get that technical, but we're talking about big chunks of chromosomes that are inherited together as, you know, as a unit, big chunks. In African populations, there's less of that because they've been around longer. There's more time to chop it up, recombine, that's what they call it, recombination. But for the older population, I mean, the more recent populations, you have these big chunks of these chromosomes. And since there's less LD, that means they were older and they had a larger population size. Also, African populations are highly subdivided, meaning the continent, you know that dark continent? They call it the dark continent. The dark continent. It's dark because there's not a lot, and people don't go, a lot of people haven't studied a lot of Africa, okay? There's enormous geographic variation, ecological variation, different climates, different ecological zones, different cultural patterns throughout Africa. And so we have this highly subdivided continent, and that's mainly due to diverse geographic and ecological zones. Now, this is the most math I'm going to give you, but pay attention to this. This is very important. Because this is, you know, at the end, when I give the test, you know. We can partition genetic variants, or we can look at genetic variation and see how it's structured, the significance of it across populations, using a statistic called FST. All right? Just know FST. So I'm going to give you three scenarios. Let's say we have two populations, one and two. All right? This scenario, FST is 100% or one. That's where you have, let's say you have two variants, A and B, and they're exclusive to each population. There's no similarity between them. That's 100% variation between populations, 0% variation within. Okay? Two homogeneous different populations. And then the next scenario is where there's equal frequencies of these variants in the two populations. So in that situation, FST is zero. When we look across the genome, we find for the most part, FST on average is about in between 10 and 15%. Here it says 11, okay? That means that the amount of variation between populations is about 11%. The amount of variation within populations is about 89%, okay? That's what we see on average when we look across and sample a lot of genetic markers, okay? So there was a study by this guy named Josh Akey. He's now in Seattle, where they looked at 26,000 SNPs. These are single nucleotide polymorphisms. These are, you know, those ACTGs? So it's like an A to a C or a T to a G change or whatever. These are changes. And so there's 26,000 of them that they looked at. And they looked at three populations, African Americans, European Americans, and Asians, East Asians. And then calculated FST. And the average FST, as I said, it's about between 10 and 15%. So it's about 13% here. And they did, they did a bend. So from 0 to 1 FST, the extremes, they looked at the distribution of, for each marker, what was its significance in terms of divergence, and found that there was a distribution that looked like this. Most of them fell into this area. That's why we have FST of about 12.8%. But there are some markers here that have a distribution that's quite high of an FST. It's greater than 4.4. In fact, 6% of the variants that they looked at had high FST, okay? That means high differentiation between those populations. Most SNPs have low FST, and a smaller number have high FST. I said that slow on purpose. They then put these SNPs on the chromosomal map and said, okay, where are these located at? Where are these SNPs located at? They're located where particular genes are that have been under selection historically. Okay, there's been some selective pressures. And so they actually were able to show that many of these SNPs are where genes are that have been under selection. And so we have this selection that might have created this, what we call modular evolution, this evolution that is not constant, but just in different regions of the genome. What type of selection? Infectious disease in Africa. You know, humanity was in Africa. There's, in tropical regions, there's enormous infectious disease load, or what we call high pathogen load. And there was this guy named James Neal who's at the University of Michigan. You guys know about Michigan, right?
Yeah.
Right. I'll tell you something about that in a sec. I'll go back to that in a sec. But this, there was this, he had this hypothesis called the thrifty gene hypothesis. And the bottom line is that humanity evolved in Africa and there was this optimum phenotype. Okay? Let's say the hunter-gatherer phenotype. Okay? And so this optimal phenotype for the traditional lifestyle of traditional populations is now not so optimal. We have what we call old world populations in westernized non-traditional lifestyles. And so what was that optimal phenotype? Greater fat storage, higher testosterone, and high salt sensitivity. Most African populations never were exposed to salt, so they don't even, you know, they don't even metabolize salt like many other populations do. Higher fat storage. It's interesting. Traditional populations, they didn't necessarily eat three meals a day. Some of you guys probably eat four meals a day, don't you? Huh? Nobody wants to talk about it. Okay, but anyway, higher fat storage. The ability to store fat was important for many of those traditional populations because they weren't eating meals every day. Okay, and in fact, if you didn't have high testosterone, you probably weren't at an advantage to go out and catch your meals. You know, you had to go out and catch those rabbits and, you know, the deer, the squirrel. They didn't have squirrels then, but are these African squirrels around? They African everything else, right? They got African bees. But higher testosterone was one of those phenotypes that made populations very successful, and in fact, still today. You find people of African descent having higher testosterone levels than, for instance, Europeans or people of Asian descent. Okay, and so there's studies that have shown this much higher testosterone among African populations. And so we have this optimal phenotype, fat storage, high testosterone, and salt sensitivity. Wow, so here you have these old world phenotypes in the westernized society, and so greater fat storage could lead to obesity if you're eating four meals a day and not exercising. Higher testosterone drives the prostate, higher levels of prostate cancer, and then salt sensitivity, hypertension, and other metabolic disorders. So these are some serious issues that we can actually explore looking at old world versus new world populations. And in fact, as I mentioned, these phenotypes might be driving what we see as these prevalence differences, or what we call health disparities. Obesity, higher in African Americans, Native Americans, and Hispanic Americans. Type 2 diabetes, also higher. End-stage renal disease, higher in African Americans. Obesity, did I say that already? Yeah. And cancer, lung cancer, higher in African Americans. Prostate cancer, that's what I studied, higher in African Americans. I got so mad I had to put something up there that blacks didn't have, so I put skin cancer. That's a problem, that's a disparity. What's the risk factor for skin cancer? Lack of melanin, eh? Right, okay. Geneticists and genetic epidemiologists, and you know, a lot of people who look at who do disease studies use race as a proxy for something. They say, okay, well, let's categorize these people based on some shared biology or genotype and some shared environment, okay? The issue is, the problem with this is you can't tease out the biology from the environment when you do that. So you say, okay, well, let's design a study, look at asthma. We're gonna have blacks, we're gonna have whites in our study, we're gonna have Hispanics in our study, okay? You say, okay, well, we're gonna recruit in this community, we're gonna ask the participants, what race are you? And they're gonna say, I'm African American. And, you know, they may be have color, skin color, you know. And you're hoping that there's some shared environmental sort of aspect to that being African American. You know, like all African Americans like fried chicken, you know that one? The watermelon thing. There's some shared culture there. Huh? That's what you're assuming, aren't you? You guys are rough today, man. Jesus. I'm going to show you why that's problematic, using race as a proxy for some shared biology and shared environment. In the United States, we have this convergence of diverse ancestries from different cultures and societies that are now here in the U.S. So we have this sampling of global diversity. We have these indigenous North Americans. You know the guys that were here before anybody else? Those guys? We have Europeans. We have Western Central Africans. And we have East Asians. And so we have this new continuum of variation that is established through admixture. The U.S. is a melting pot. You know, we have this continuum of variation. You guys agree? Right? It is a melting pot, okay? However, in the United States, it's still, whether it's a melting pot or not, the issue is still black or white, okay? It's highly polarized social political history. And it's predicated on issues such as slavery and segregation, anti-miscegenation, and the one-drop rule. Now, the one-drop rule is very interesting, very, very interesting. I'm going to talk about that a little more in a second, but the anti-miscegenation laws are fascinating because a lot of those started in South Carolina. And South Carolina was always one of the vanguards in terms of during the period of slavery. They were the ones that just, you know, they dealt with issues head on. South Carolina was very, you know, not only corrupt, but it was just very, very antagonistic, and there's a lot of, you know, that's really, you talk about the Wild West, you know, you talk about wild South South Carolina. In the Lowcountry in particular, many of the slaveholders, many of the wives of the slaveholders were getting tired of their husbands going out to the cabins and having their way with many of the enslaved African women. And so they petitioned the courts in South Carolina to set up these anti-miscegenation laws because they wanted their husbands to, you know, stay in the house with them. You know, they talk about the sweet of the berry, that thing, you know? So they set up those anti-miscegenation laws. Set them up so that, you know, you know, the women, they started the whole petition. But then there were issues such as what to do with many of those children that were of mixed ancestries. And then there was money and property issues that had to be established. And so what came out of it? The one drop rule, or the rule of hypo descent, also started in South Carolina and then spread throughout the South and the rest of the United States. That rule says if a person has at least one African ancestor, a person of African descent in their family line, they are considered what?
Black.
Well, back then it was, you know, Negro, and it was even worse than that. But that's what that meant. And it started in South Carolina during the period of slavery, and then it expanded out from that. And it became so entrenched in society that even African Americans, or blacks, accepted the rule and started using it. And so today, Halle Berry can come in, walk in right now. She can come right in. And she'll say, yeah, I'm black. And we'll say, yeah, you are, right? Have a seat. She can sit right there. But we know that 50% of her genes come from Europe. Is her mother from European descent?
Yeah.
50% of her genes come from Europe, and 50% come from Africa. Or we believe 50%. So it might be at least 50% of her genes are from Europe, because her father could be mixed, right? Mm-hmm. Wesley Snipes can come in. We'll say, yeah, we were black. And so we have those, and everybody in between, okay? So the one drop rule really has increased the amount of genetic heterogeneity or biological diversity in the African-American population. That's significant. That's not something, I'm not just saying this, I'm not a historian. I'm just telling you genetically how society has impacted on the genetics. Did I say that right? I'm telling you how society has impacted on the genetics of the African-American population. That's very important. We're gonna come back to this in a second. But the one drop rule has increased the amount of genetic diversity in the African-American population. Think about it. There's enormous physical variation. Some African Americans say, oh, I have good hair. I got some Native American in me. Yeah, uh-huh. The one drop rule is interesting. Bam! I find this interesting. This was very interesting. You know, he gave us liberty in the pursuit of happiness. The radical mind. He was radical, all right. This guy. This is not anything new. I'm going back to Thomas Jefferson for a reason, okay? And it didn't start with him, and it definitely didn't end with him. And he was radical. He actually wrote that we hold these truths to be what? Self-evident, that all men, except women, you know, all men are created equal, except my slaves, okay? He didn't put that in there was no clause there, but that's what he meant. People say, well, what, this guy, he wrote some major works that, you know, that have been the foundation in which this country has been built on. But you got to think about, what did he mean? He meant all white men are created equal. And then he went back to the home and, you know, hooked up with Sally and, you know. And still today, they're fighting, these families are fighting. They just want a piece of the Jefferson. You know, the bottom line is this, I call it the Jefferson effect. Didn't start with him, okay? So because of Thomas Jefferson, when we look at the genetic features of the African-American population, it's high genetic heterogeneity, high genetic variation. Genetic variation, a lot, it's high. Why? Because of the antiquity of being African. I told you African populations are diverse because they've been around longest, all right? They're large in size, different ecological zones. There's a lot of genetic diversity in Africa. And also, admixture to some extent with non-African populations, European, Americans, Native Americans to some extent. And the pattern of variation differs geographically. And so we have high levels of population stratification that could mess up any association, genetic association study that you're trying to do. I'm going to show you some data. I'm just not going to talk about it anymore. I'm just going to show you. When we talk about the antiquity of being African, we're talking about from northern Senegal to southern Angola and all this in between, and to about 5% of enslaved Africans came from East Africa. The historians have, you know, they really good records. You know why there's such good records for the slave trade? Because it was money. You keep good records when you're making money, don't you? Or at least you should. At least 10 million enslaved Africans were taken from the coast of West and Central Africa and brought to the Americas, okay? And these are some of the forts. One of the defining features of these forts are interesting. A defining feature are these cannons. You see them all over these forts, from the Gori Island to Angola, this fort in Luanda, to Amina Castle in Ghana. Cannons, why? Because it was money and profit, and they had to protect their territory, okay? So what could be some of the biological or genetic consequences of this Middle Passage experience? Let's think about it. A ship, maybe even smaller than this room, containing double the amount of people in this room, packed, set on a trek from West and Central Africa that took 3 months to cross the Atlantic. 3 months. Imagine being locked in this room for 3 months. You know, some of you gotta go to the bathroom right now, right? The doors are shut, they're locked, you can't go nowhere. You're locked to your seat. 3 months. In a week, there'd be a significant number of you guys not here anymore. Your body might be here, but your spirit would be gone. Do you see what I'm saying? So 3 months trek, very little water, very little food. It was high mortality rates. Some historians think that, you know, range the mortality rate to be between 15% and 30-some%. That's a lot. Let's just say 20% of y'all are gone. That's like this whole section here. Let's say this whole section here, you guys just weren't able to retain water as good as the rest of these guys. Or there was a bout of cholera or dysentery, and it just wiped you out. But these guys had some genetic polymorphisms that protected them against that bacteria. All right? That's a lot of what happened on these ships. These epidemics wiped out significant numbers of people. And so that might have actually contributed to what we see today when we talk about these health disparities. Hypertension, water retention, or salt sensitivity, obesity, prostate cancer, all of these could be a result or the consequence of the Middle Passage experience. There are people looking at it. There's no strong evidence for or against it, but it's something that people need to look at. Now, are these genetic or not? Or are they a result of systematic racism and poverty? We're talking about the effects of racism that could wipe out generations of people. You think about it. Some of you guys, you go to work and you sit down and your boss yells at you and your anxiety levels go up. You almost have a heart attack just because your boss yelled at you. So imagine if you grew up every day experiencing stuff like that, all right? How that would affect your health. Anyway, are these the results of some genetic consequences or the result of some use of race? Now, if we define black and white, in some way, we can actually create these categories or these prevalence differences, especially when you use race as a causal variable that perpetuates biological determinism, such as the Tuskegee experiments with syphilis. You know, these people are given, they're not given syphilis. They have syphilis, they're just not given medication. And for their, you know, what was that study called? The study that examined the natural history of syphilis. As if your syphilis is different than mine. Y'all didn't get that one, okay. I should have used a different example, but they actually looked at that in Tuskegee over decades. And then sickle cell disease, which is a disease that has a major racial label. You know, it's a black disease, an African disease. So when the enslaved Africans came to the US, they were brought to different ports or of entry. Charleston, the Lowcountry, Virginia, the Chesapeake Bay Area, New York City, and Louisiana. Before I get started, who here is from Louisiana? Anybody? Okay, just one. I can do it then. Look, there were different economies. There were different plantation complexes. And in New York City, there wasn't even plantation complexes. Many of them were just servants, domestic servants, many of the enslaved Africans. But in the Lowcountry, they wanted enslaved Africans who knew how to grow rice, and so a lot of Africans from the grain coast were brought here. A lot of Ghanaians were brought to Virginia area because of malaria was high. It was very swampy. When you grow tobacco, it's a lot of water. It's very humid. And mosquitoes are in high numbers. And so malaria was big. It was wiping out people except those who actually had protection against it. And those were like Gold Coast Africans. But New Orleans is interesting. They brought everybody on. See, the French controlled New Orleans. They behaved quite differently than the English and the Spanish. Anybody Frenchy?
Parlez-vous français?
While the Brits and the Spanish, you know, set up these systems like miscegenation laws and these rules against whites and blacks mixing, the French actually encouraged it. So much so that they had these social balls called placots or something like that. And so they'd come in, and when these young white men got of age, they'd come into these balls, and they'd be enslaved African women all around, and they'd pick and choose who they wanted to sleep with. And in some cases, they actually negotiated with the woman's mother, and you know, where if a child is born, you will send him to France and educate him and blah, 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 blah. And that's why here we see a quite different signature of admixture in Louisiana than we do, especially in the rural South, like Georgia, South Carolina. Quite different signature. I'm going to show you some data. African Americans went up north for better jobs in the early 1900s. And I put this point in here because we recruit African Americans for hereditary prostate cancer. We have a national study. We look for families where you have a high incidence of prostate cancer. And what we find when we go to Chicago or Detroit or Cleveland, that most of the family roots are down here in the Mississippi, Oklahoma, Tennessee, Arkansas area. There's cousins up here, but the family roots are down there. And that's because of the migration up north. But for the most part, African Americans are pretty much where they were brought. The Crescent States in the South, this is the last census. This is where you find at least 50% or more African Americans. Look at the Mississippi River. Huh? See that? That's Chicago, Detroit. Look at that dot there in central Pennsylvania. That's an all-black township, part of the Underground Railroad. Still black today. It's called Mount Union. Anybody know about Mount Union?
Yep.
Who said that? Oh, okay. It was black. You don't see many black folk out here. That's where you find blacks, large numbers. Hispanics, this is the last census also. This is where you find Hispanics. Blacks, Hispanics, blacks, Hispanics, blacks, Hispanics, blacks, Hispanics. What's the dividing line? Texas. Well, what's interesting is that Hispanics are just as diverse as African Americans. Why? Because it's just these people just speak Spanish. That's all. They have completely diverse, I mean, quite distinct and different ancestries. So here in New Mexico, Texas, Southern California, these Hispanics are quite different than the Hispanics here in Miami or in New York City. These have strong Native American and Spanish ancestry. These Hispanics in Miami, Puerto Ricans and Cubans, quite different. J-Lo. That's all I gotta say. Well, for those who don't know what I'm saying, they have African ancestry, okay? Much more so than these guys here, but they're all clumped in as Hispanic. So if you want to go ahead and create a study, design a study, say I'm going to look at asthma among the Hispanic populations, you better make sure you define your Hispanic populations well. Just because they speak Spanish doesn't mean that they share a similar genetic ancestry. This is interesting. The last census, they actually said, you don't have to be white or black. This is the first time. You can be of mixed race. So, who got excited? Tiger Woods got excited. This is that new way of thinking. Now, you gotta understand, African Americans, for the most part, accepted the one drop rule. And that's why we're so diverse as a population. We're what I call a macro ethnic group, okay? We share a certain cultural significance, but we have diverse biological ancestries. So anyway, we find people of mixed ancestry, large numbers out west. This is where black folk are. How come these guys aren't saying they're mixed? Huh? Don't take this the wrong way, but I see this as the old blacks and the new blacks. All right, the Tiger Woods thing. And you can define yourself however you want to. I think it's important that you define yourself. Don't leave it to me. I'll do it, but don't, you know. This is interesting. This is Oklahoma. So there's African Americans here, there's some black freedmen townships, I'm going to show you some data from there, that when you ask, these are black towns, and you go to these people and you say, what are you? They'll say, I'm black and I'm Native American. They don't want to be called African American. They want to be called black Indians. That's what they say, black Indians. To be a Native American is very important to them. Now, there's some Native American ancestry in these African Americans over here, but it's not that significant to them. Why is that? Because of the context in which they live. There's land here, land rights, oil rights, all kind of rights that black folk don't get over here. So it's important for them to define themselves as black Indians. I don't even like the term Indian, but they say I'm a black Indian, okay? They're part of that trail of tears from Seminoles when they went out and they were incorporated in those five major Native American tribes. Now, how did black folk get into the Seminole tribe? Well, they were enslaved Africans that went into the wilderness of Florida and escaped and became incorporated socially, for the most part, into these Native American groups. Okay, so somebody's great-great-grandfather became socially accepted into the Seminoles, and then now they're in Oklahoma, a descendant of this person, and they swear before Congress that they are of Indian blood. When we look at the genetics, it doesn't necessarily say that. And so we have this now, we have to reconcile this. We have to reconcile that socially you might have been incorporated into this, but biologically there's no bloodline or there's no genetic connection. So who's black, who's African? It depends on where you are. The U.S. is quite different than Brazil. In the U.S., legally and socially defined by this one drop rule, a rule of hypo descent. However, now we have these genetic markers. These genetic markers are very interesting because they allow us to infer ancestry. Remember I showed you that distribution with those SNPs? The tail of that distribution represent markers that are informative for ancestry because they're common in different continents. Like, for instance, this what we call Duffy null, FY null. It's fixed in West Africa. This is the green bars represent West African populations. It's fixed, 100%. And it's quite rare in Europe, Britain, Germany, and European Americans, it's rare. So that's a highly informative marker. For the most part, if you look at somebody of West African descent, you'll see this marker. And then these are African Americans, so you see they're intermediate between these two. The yellow represent African Americans. Green and West Africans, African Americans, and then here's European Americans. So we look for markers like that in the genome. There's about 6% of all the SNPs, or like 5 or 6% are like that. And we call them ancestry informative markers. And so when we look at like 200 of these, statistically we have a lot of power to infer continental ancestry. Not, you know, particular groups within those continents, but just continental ancestry. And so this is a program where we looked at some aims, some ancestry informative markers. And it's a Bayesian algorithm that determines individual ancestry. And so we go from 0 to 100%. And these are, across this line, represent individuals. So what we did was we looked at these markers, like Duffy null, and looked at some West Africans from Cameroon. And we found that, for the most part, these guys had about at least 95, 98% West African ancestry. That's why it's all red here. You see that? So then, I was at Howard at the time, and I didn't have access to a lot of white DNA from white folk. So I called my buddies up in Baltimore. See, that's what they do. They call me for the black DNA, and I call them for the white DNA. But now I'm in Ohio, so I can get, you know. So I called my buddies at Hopkins. I said, you know, can you give me a tray of DNA from European Americans? They said, okay. They sent it, and we typed these markers in these individuals. Lo and behold, there's about 8 people here with significant African ancestry represented by the red here. See, green represent percent European ancestry, red is African. So there were some 8 people on that tray of DNA that had greater than 95% African ancestry. So I called up my buddy. I said, you know, I thought you sent me a tray of whites. That doesn't. He said, I did. I said, well, can you check? And he went back. He said, oh, man, there were 8 blacks on there. You know, we just throw them in there because, you know, we don't have many, so we just throw them in there with the whites. And so I kept this here just to show you guys that these markers are quite informative. And they allowed us to trace back and say, look, you know, you didn't give us European Americans, 100% are European Americans. In fact, they were a significant number that were of African descent. And had we have not done this, we would have, in our studies, counted them as whites. But what's the most significant thing here is that when we looked at African Americans from D.C., look at the amount of heterogeneity that's there. These are folk who say that they're black. This is not me saying you're black. They self-identified as African American. Look at the level of heterogeneity. There are some people that have almost 100% African ancestry, and there are some people who have almost 100% European ancestry. Enormous genetic heterogeneity, all right? So some of them could be like Halle Berry, I keep throwing her name, Halle Berry, and others could be like me, 100% Mandinka, okay? So then we went and started cataloging different African-American communities across the U.S. We did this in collaboration with Mark Shriver at Penn State. And so we looked at Chicago, Detroit, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, D.C., New York, at Delaware, and in the South. And we found, for the most part, this is a map showing the percent European ancestry among African-Americans. So it's about 20% up north in African-American populations. And there would be significant differences between urban north and the rural south if it wasn't for this population here in New Orleans. They just mess everything up. I told you, you got to place everything into some social context. The African-Americans in Louisiana are just different. They're not, there's nothing wrong with them or nothing. They're just different, different histories, different experiences. The African-American experience is quite diverse. Okay? And it depends on where you are. For example, let's look at South Carolina. The vanguards in race relations since slavery. The Gullah Islands, right there, 3.5% European ancestry. These are descendants, direct descendants of enslaved Africans who've been pretty well isolated since slavery. Very little European ancestry. Charleston, about 10%. And then, as you go mainland, 18% in Columbia, which is the capital, Columbia, South Carolina. It's a major highway runs through there. Big trucks. There's some colleges there. And guess what? Jeans have legs. Think about it. Any opportunity you hit, there are going to be people coming together if they're brought in the same proximity. And so, in Columbia, South Carolina, it's much higher European ancestry than even in Charleston or the Gullah Sea Islands. Atlanta, about 10%. Mississippi and Alabama, very low. But this messed everything up. There would be significant differences between the North and the South if it wasn't for New Orleans. Then we looked out west at the new blacks. I say new blacks because socially, it's more acceptable for whites and blacks to hold hands and walk down the street in California and Washington State than it is in Mississippi and Alabama. Right? Can we agree on that? Okay, this is the new way of thinking. You don't even have to be black anymore. You can say you're Cablasian, okay? I think that's cool. You know, that'll sort of be the opposite of this one drop rule in a sense. But it doesn't matter because they're still not going to be able to get a cab. This is what we call a triangular plot. And what we did was we plotted the individual ancestry using these ancestry informative markers for about 220 African Americans from DC and about 200 whites or European Americans from State College. And the dark spots are the African Americans, the open circles are the European Americans. And so this is the distribution that we see. This would be 100% West African, 100% European, 100% Native American, okay? Based on the markers. So we see it's quite diverse there in terms of the spread of ancestry. But look here, I bring your attention to the red box. There are some African Americans who say they're African American who genetically are just as European or more so than some Europeans in terms of their genetic ancestry. Now, why would that be? Well, because that's Halle Berry. No, let me stop. I like to kid with that, but I'll explain something in a second why I keep saying that. But this is important, because what does that say? There's no line that divides black and white. Genetically, you know, there's this blurry, you can create a line if you want, but there's no real, you know, strict separation here between white and black. And I find this to be quite interesting. So if you include these people in your genetic study, and base it on just because they said they're black or they said they're white, you're going to create a lot of confusion when you do your analyses. All right? These are Hispanics from St. Louis Valley. My postdoc, Carolina Bonicia, she did this where she looked at ancestry informative markers that allow in these St. Louis Valley Hispanics. These are Hispanics. And look at the distribution, European to Native American. Very little West African ancestry. You guys got that? Now, she then went and did the J-Lo crew. Puerto Ricans, look at the distribution. Very little Native American, more European, West African ancestry. Some of them were 100%. Quite different than Hispanics from St. Louis Valley, Colorado. Just as diverse. And it's because of what we know about the experience of slavery on those islands, in Cuba and Puerto Rico. Significant islands or participation in the transatlantic slave trade. I told you guys that, you know, I could kid about other people, but I should be able to kid about myself too. But this is the truth. So I did this, I tested myself, looked at a series of, I think this is about 200 ancestry informative markers. And so when we estimated, we did the calculations, about 88% West African, about 12% European ancestry. And so this is how I fit in that spectrum of African American genetic variation. Now, my father told me when I was in high school, or middle school, that there was this white ancestor in the family. And I said, oh, that's great. You know? It didn't really affect me. You know, it's not like if I got stopped by the cops, I could say, look, you know, I'm like 12%, you know. This is my buddy Mark Shriver. He looks white, right? White, average white guy. 68% European, 16% West African, 16% Native American. Mark had to deal, he had to go home and deal with this. Mark had to, he had to do some reconciling. His family had to do some reconciling. And still, I don't know the answer. He won't tell me what's going on. I think it has something to do with his grandfather or something. But according to the one drop rule, Mark should be a brother, huh? And it's okay with him because he knows he can get a cab. You see what I'm saying? It's all right. You call him a brother if you want, but you know, in society, they, you know, it's different. It's, you know, just on the skin color. So, what do we know about particular loci between Mark and I? Who has that Duffy, the one that's fixed in West Africa, 100% in West Africa? Who has the different mitochondrial DNA, which is maternally inherited, and Y chromosome, which is paternally inherited? Well, I don't have any copy. I didn't get one from my mother, that Duffy null. I didn't get one from my father. So on both sides of my family, there was some admixture. And I was pretty upset about that. You know, because I was 100% Mandingo. You know? It's crushed. But I do have West African mitochondrial DNA. In fact, it's common among the Hausa in Nigeria, northern Nigeria. But I had a European Y chromosome. And I kind of figured that out because my father said, you're great, great, great grandfather was white. And I said, okay, great. That's great. You know, like I said, it didn't have any impact because as a black male living in the United States, you know, when I walk down the street, I am black and a threat for the most part. Even though I'm not a big guy, you know, women clutch their purses, you know. You know, mortgage companies close the books. You know, those are serious issues. So Mark has one of those Duffy nulls. He has one of those African alleles. And he was quite excited. In fact, to this day, he says he's more black than me. Because of this. And he has a Native American, this haplotype B, Native American mitochondrial DNA, maternal lineage, and a European Y chromosome. Okay? So we can use genetic markers. This is a study that Mark and I published in Nature Reviews Genetics, looking at genetic ancestries. And this is for instance, with mitochondrial DNA, which tells the maternal history of modern humans out of Africa and the different types that we see due to evolutionary processes and migrations. And so I've been privileged to work with this company that actually looks at genetic ancestry of African Americans. And so we've looked at about 3,000 African Americans. And in fact, we find a significant portion, about 36%, having ancestry from the grain coast. That's like Liberia, Sierra Leone, Guinea, and about 27% from Nigeria, or the Bita-Benin area, and the Bita-Biafra in Cameroon, about 16%. Ghana, about 10%. Now, this is not a random sample. These are just people who bought tests. But, you know, about 3,000 of them, it just says something about the amount of variation in the African-American population. So when we talk about these lineages, these non-African lineages in African-Americans, you know how we say, we have good hair, I got some Native American ancestry. You guys know what I'm talking about. My mother used to tell me that all the time, back when I had hair. She used to say, yo, I got Native American ancestry on my mama's side, because, you know, all your aunties and I got nice hair. That's what we say. But for the most part, we claim Native American ancestry before we do European ancestry. I think that's why we sort of, you hear these stories. But anyway, when we look at mitochondrial DNA, we find it only in 3%. Very little Native American ancestry among African Americans on the maternal lineage, and even less on the paternal side. Very little thus far. That's why the gentleman there said you're Native American or something. You have French ancestry. I'm just playing. European ancestry is quite different. Very little maternal European ancestry. That's from women. Extremely large amount for men. In fact, 30%. So in this room, if we were to count out 10 black men, three of y'all folks would have a European Y chromosome or a paternal lineage. European, it wouldn't be African, it'd be European. And I can guarantee you, I'd bet $1 billion on it. And I'll show you data. We look across many different populations in the United States, African American, in the Caribbean, African descent populations. 3 out of 10 have European Y chromosomes. And that's mainly due to the behavior of slaveholders during a period of slavery. This is striking. Very little gene flow from white women, an extreme amount from white men into the African American population. Oh, that's that Y chromosome I was showing you about, telling you about. That little blurb, that little piece of DNA, that chunk of chromosome is what creates so much havoc in the world. This is the X, this is the Y, it's magnified 10,000 times. So there's a couple of genes here that code for leaving the toilet seat up, and testosterone, you know, talking to the TV. That remote control gene is on there. This is what I was talking about. We looked at four populations in the Americas. These are African descent populations. We saw a significant structure or variation among the groups. But they were from South Carolina, D.C., St. Thomas. It was very hard to go there in December and do this research. So hard. The Virgin Islands, I mean, it took a lot. That was probably the most difficult study I've ever done. In Jamaica, too. And so percent European, these are percent paternal ancestry. Percent European, 30% on average, about 30-40% across all those populations. Okay? Now that's quite significant. Quite significant. Oh, these are black Americans. See Halle Berry. Vanessa Williams. Black Americans. Wesley Snipes. Halle Berry. Black Americans. Oh, you remember her? What was her name? Stacy, yeah, she was the crazy one, wasn't she? She was in what, The Apprentice? Yeah. Right, they said she was crazy. I think she's psycho. And then people say, well, how come black folk get kicked off these shows before anybody else? I was like, because it's reality. It's a reality show. These are black folk. That's my daughter. Beautiful, isn't she? She's a genius. We call her baby genius. Black folk, wait a minute. You see that? Because race in the US is largely based on skin color and ancestry, we continually have to reconcile. That's Vijay Singh, y'all. He's not African. He just gets darker after every tournament. You see what I'm saying? But he's not African. Some people in the back say, oh, that's Denzel Washington. No, wait a minute. You gotta come up close and you say, oh, so, we consistently have to reconcile these issues, in especially in the U.S. Say, oh, I could walk down the street and tell you who's black, who's white. It's not that simple. It's not that simple.
Skin color is interesting.
Skin color is how we define, for the most part, race. Skin color, eye shape, and hair texture. For the most part, dark-skinned populations are in the old world, 20 degrees north of the equator, 20 degrees south. That's where you find the darkest skin. Okay? And so we use this instrument called the dermispec. Why are you laughing? To get an objective measure. I'm gonna come over here. To get an objective measure of skin color. So we don't just say this person's darker than this person. This is objective measure. Light shines from this, hits the skin, bounces back. And we measure in the unexposed area to get what, you know, a baseline it's not impacted by the environment. And in some cases we wanted to do it in the higher buttocks area, but the women didn't want us to look, you know, down like that. So we do the inner arm. So for African Americans, it's interesting. We have a range of variation from 0 to 100%. And so these are sort of some of the phenotypes. You know, when you see these physically, we actually have a good measurement of them, of melanin content. Melanin is interesting because there's cells called melanocytes that are like dendritic cells that produce melanin. And we know a lot about the pathways. We're now exploring these particular genes that code for these receptors and proteins and enzymes, such as the P gene and a gene called the Golgi signaling protein, which we believe contributes a lot. So the P gene is interesting. Mutations in the P gene cause this albinism called OCA2, ocular cutaneous albinism 2. And it's the recessive disorder. This individual has it. The interesting feature is that you can produce a tiny bit of melanin. So you have this reddish, brownish pigment, like for instance in the hair. His child is an albino, but the mother is, his wife is not. And so that's how they figured it was recessive, because she's a carrier. And so the child got one of the recessive alleles from the mother. So we looked at this gene, which is on chromosome 15, and we wanted to explore the relationship with variation, normal variation, and normal variation in skin color. So we looked at different populations. This is the distribution in skin color from light to dark for different populations. The blue represent European Americans from State College. The black here represent African Americans. And the red represent very dark-skinned people from Papua New Guinea, you know, like the Australian Aborigine type, very, very dark. In fact, they're darker than the darkest folks we saw in D.C. There was significant overlap, but they still, you know, the distribution was more, they were more darker than the darkest African Americans. One of the things we did among the African American population was we looked at genetic ancestry and skin color and found there was a relationship. In fact, 15% of the variation in skin color among African Americans is due to percent European ancestry. The higher the ancestry, the less darker you are, the lighter you are. It's not a one-to-one relationship, but it did show a relationship. I bring this to your attention over here. These individuals have 100% West African ancestry, or zero European. You guys got that? But look at the distribution in skin color. Very light to very dark, okay? So what does that mean? That means that within Africa, these genes that influence skin color are in Africa, and you also should be able to see a wide range of diversity in Africa. And in fact, we do. You look at populations in Nigeria and Senegal, you see very light-skinned people, you see very dark-skinned people. So that stereotype of the big-lipped, dark-skinned, bone-in-the-nose African is pretty, you know, it's pretty bogus. You know, there's enormous diversity in Africa. We looked at the P gene. We found that there were particular variants, genetic variants, that were common among African descent groups or darker skinned people, and there were some that were common in the rest of the world. But these Melanesian islanders from Papua New Guinea had both the African common African variants, and they also had the common Asian variants. And so it was interesting when we saw this. In fact, we were able to determine that the P gene contributes about 16, almost 17% of the variance in skin color is due to that one gene alone. And the Golgi signaling protein is about 5.5%. In fact, this is the ancestral allele. Very dark-skinned people have the ancestral allele, and it gets lighter as you get this mutation in terms of genotypes. You guys got that? So we have two genes here that vary across populations that impact on skin color. So what do these findings imply about race and the question of health disparities? It's a fallacy. It's typological. There's no, oh, I got it to work today. Great. You guys like that, huh? Let's do it again. There are no bounded groups. Typological race does not exist. In fact, there's significant overlap there, okay, with these populations. Now, let's go back to race as a proxy. How do we tease out, when you do a genetic study, you want to find the genetic contribution to the disease, right? How do you tease that away from the cultural aspect when you use race as a proxy? Oh my God. It's hard, it's very hard. But one way to do it is to type those markers like I was talking about, those ancestry informative markers, because then you're teasing out the shared biology from the environment. Prostate cancer is interesting. Highest among African Americans, they present at a more advanced stage, and these differences suggest that genetic factors play a role. When you look at populations of African descent, it's quite high, it's quite common, the incidence of prostate cancer. And so why these differences? Is it because higher testosterone? Is it because of UV and vitamin D? Is it because of environmental factors, diet, exercise? Or is it some overall increased genetic susceptibility among populations of African descent? Well, we've looked at a whole slew of these candidate genes that are involved in these pathways leading to testosterone and the availability of testosterone in the prostate cell. But this is something I wanted to show you guys. When you look at vitamin D, there are studies have shown that vitamin D actually inhibits cancer cells growth or tumor growth, tumor cell growth. And so for not just prostate, but also breast and colon and cervical cancer. And so what's interesting is that vitamin D is made in the skin. And so there are some people who believe that darker skin populations are at higher risk. So this is a distribution from low risk to high risk in terms of skin color and prostate cancer, UV exposure, dietary vitamin D, and then some genetic background. So we're actually testing this now, and we're getting some very interesting information thus far. And so it'll be interesting to see what comes about. The last point I want to make deals with race and pharmacogenomics. This is a recent article in the New England Journal of Medicine. It's the Bea L story. You guys may have heard this. It's a drug targeted for blacks with heart failure. It's a combination drug of these two, isosorbide, dinitrate, and hydralazine. What's interesting is these guys actually wrote this in their paper. Studies have suggested that persons who identify themselves as black may have, on average, a less active renin-angiotensin system and lower bioavailability of nitric oxide than those self-identified as whites. So, and that's a correct statement. In fact, you know, the angiotensin system in populations of African descent is quite different than populations of European descent. And it appears to be due to some selection that occurred a long time. So this is pretty true. But this is what I found quite interesting. Our trial represents a departure from the recent approach to the design of cardiovascular trials. Rather than studying a large heterogeneous population, we examined a specific population. A heterogeneous population may have substantial variations in genetic and environmental factors that influence disease progression and response to therapy. So what was that specific homogeneous population they looked at? Blacks. What did I show you guys earlier? The amount of variation that's there. And that's why 43% of those blacks who took the drug had an improvement in survival. It wasn't 100%. So, you know, this whole issue of race-based medicine is problematic. What we should be doing is more individualized treatments based on genotypes and not necessarily these crude proxies of race. For instance, who were those blacks that they looked at? They had 160 different recruitment sites, and they ended up with about 1,000 African Americans. Now, depending on where on that map, remember I showed you, quite different biologies and different genetic, different environmental situations. And so it's problematic when you use race as a crude proxy and say this is for blacks, okay? There was a significant improvement, but it was only in 40%. What about the other 60%? The trial did not test other groups, so you can't say if, in fact, it works better in blacks than whites. It just did blacks, okay? Now, I'm not harping on the drug as being bad, because I'm very cautiously optimistic about it. I believe if it works for even a small percentage of African Americans, it's good. But doctors should not be prescribing it to all African Americans. That's all I'm saying, just because a person has dark skin.
So this 43% improvement in survival is interesting. The bottom line is, what are the genetic variants, that the functional variants that interact with the drug that cause it to be more efficacious? More effective, yeah. I didn't want to use the term efficacious. Okay. More effective. What is it? What is the genetic background of those individuals? That's what the outcome, that's what we should be looking at. And so that's the main point that I want to break. Last point. I talked about genetics a lot, but the bottom line is Kamara Jones, she's an epidemiologist at the CDC. She has this really good model for the impact of racism on health. It calls this a racial climate, and there's three components: internalized, institutionalized, and personally mediated. The internalized are this health behaviors, you know, like smoking and drinking and, you know, how you feel about yourself internally, how you feel about yourself as a so-called minority in a minority population, okay? Then you have this institutionalized racial climate, which deals with SES and access to healthcare and the quality of the healthcare, all of which influences health outcomes. And then the personally mediated. How do you respond to stress? People who have darker skin appear to be more stressed because they experience racism more. That's true. I know some really light-skinned white blacks, real light-skinned blacks, who experience less racism than I do. You know, it's horrible. This is data from the Pew. And I get upset when I see this. These are Hispanics. This is medium net worth of households by race and ethnicity. Hispanics, blacks, whites. Enormous range there, difference there. So when we talk about health disparities, are we really talking about wealth disparities? So in summary, modern human genetic variation is not structured into races. Human populations exhibit diverse patterns of variation due to differences in population history and local adaptations. It's very important. African Americans are a genetically heterogeneous macro ethnic group, very diverse macro ethnic group. That word right there, macro ethnic group, it's important. Write it down, macro ethnic group. With diverse ancestries and continental U.S. experiences, historically classified by the one drop rule, they exhibit significant substructure within the population. We need to take genetic ancestry into account in our biomedical studies, study designs. So, self-identified race alone is not going to help us. In fact, it will be a confounder based on, you think about that pattern of variation among those African Americans. And it's not just genetic heterogeneity, it's also social SES heterogeneity. We need to figure out the effects of race and skin color and racism on health. And that's what Kamara Jones is working on at the CDC, and I find that quite interesting. And also explore the physiological challenges when old world populations adapt westernized lifestyles. And I'd like to thank all my collaborators.
So unfortunately, because of the late hour and someone else needing the room, we're not going to be able to take questions. But I want to thank you all for coming this evening and help me thank Rick again for, I think, a really stellar performance.